Can everyone hear me all right? Can you guys hear me in the back? Thumbs up? Yeah, good. All right, thank you. Welcome to the professor panel on climate change. We're delighted to have three professors, ISU professors, here with us this evening. We have, starting on your right here, Professor Stefan Schmidt, a university professor in political science, aka Dr. Politics. And seated next to him, we have Professor Gene Tockley in the Atmospheric Sciences Department. And seated next to him, we have Professor John Wernowski in the Economics Department, who specializes in environmental economics. First of all, I'd like to thank a few groups and mention who's putting this on. This event was actually initiated by the student group Activist, which is running the Campus Climate Challenge. This is really our push to make sure that we get out and educate the students and public on climate change. I'd also like to thank the Committee on Lectures for supporting this event, and we'd also like to thank Engineers for Sustainable World and the Political Science Club for co-sponsoring this event as well. Approximately the first 45 minutes of the lecture this evening will consist of scripted questions that the professors will answer in about 5-minute intervals. And after that, we'll move on to public questions. So if you guys have any, anything that comes up, feel free to line up at the bottom here at around 8:45, 8:50, and we'll be sure to get to you. All right? We're going to cover four topics today. The first one will be the progression of opinions and methods on climate change, just as a subject. We'll start with Professor Tockley. In the past 20 years, how has the scientific assessment and certainty of global warming changed?
The scientific community, of course, has been extremely active in the last 25 years, initiated in large measure by the establishment of the International Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which is an international consortium of scientists from all disciplines looking at a variety of issues relating to climate change. And that group has now issued its fourth assessment report. The summary for policymakers of this report came out in February, and the rest of it is going to be dribbled out over the course of the year. And this represents by far the consensus of what scientists who are active in the basic science of climate change and the impacts of climate change think or agree that is represents our best understanding of the state of science of climate. And what has happened over the past 25 years is that there has been significant improvements in our ability to model the climate. And modeling is extremely important because of the fact that if we try to understand what our future climate looks like, is going to look like, our first reaction is to look at the past. What can we learn from looking at past climates? But we have no climate in the past 450,000 years that has as much CO2 as we have in our atmosphere today. So we don't have any climate that we can look to in the past. So we use models to project into the future. It's our only way to peer into the future. And so there's been a substantial improvement in modeling, and the main result of the past 25 years is that we can now tease out the differences between natural variations and human influences on the climate system. The differences between these curves is beyond the range of uncertainty in the individual models and ensembles of models. So we have high confidence that humans now are having a significant influence on changes in the climate.
The next one will be for Dr. Schmidt. How has global warming and the political issue changed since the 1980s?
Well, one of the things that's interesting is that a lot of people don't believe scientists. And it's been very difficult for the scientific community to essentially break through and convince the public, voters, and general public opinion that human activities are the principal cause of climate change and, in particular, global warming. And that's, you know, created a kind of interesting problem. The second issue is that even if human activities do impact heavily on climate, and if you agree that that is the case, a lot of the developing countries have argued that they should not be subjected to regulations that would slow their economic development, because the industrialized countries had a chance to grow, develop, industrialize, and become prosperous while polluting the heck out of the world. And it wouldn't be fair to cut off countries like China and India and Indonesia, for example, which are pretty serious polluters, from developing quickly, growing economically, even though they may be polluting, because it just wouldn't be fair. So the politics of it is very complicated. On the one hand, convincing people that climate change and global warming is important. Number two, that human activities are the principal causes of it. Number three, that all countries should engage in activities to reduce that. And between those, it's a very complex sort of a multidimensional issue, which in the end is a political issue, because it does deal with the question of what governments are going to do to regulate behavior, economic activities, and technology. So we're right now at the moment, fortunately, where most people do, I think, accept most of the science. And that's a huge step, because we weren't doing that before. Now the question is how we convert that into public policy.
Excellent, thank you. Dr. Marinowski, in the last several decades, how has air pollution policy approaches changed with regard to economic considerations and use of market mechanisms?
Okay, we've seen some very big changes over the last, particularly, four decades. We started out with particularly the Clean Air Act amendments in 1970 and our early water quality legislation. That was what we referred to as command and control. It's basically the government coming in, setting some standard or limit, and then deciding what technologies, what approaches would be used to achieve that outcome. That's evolved a lot in the last 30 years. We've now moved into, particularly the last 20 years, we've now moved into much more of market-based solutions and some voluntary programs. I'm not going to say much about voluntary programs. We don't have very good evidence that they work, but it's another way of trying to get businesses under the threat of stiffer regulations or other controls to make a change. Now, one of the things about the system of direct controls or regulation is that you need to have enforcement or policing of what's happening in the process. And for the most part, we haven't been very good at getting that or having much of that. If you look at where we make budget cuts, even in the state budget, we tend to cut out those enforcement activities as part of the picture. So we're trying to get it, in a sense, almost voluntarily, by issuing permits and then moving forward. We've moved much more to a market-based system, or we're moving much more in that direction. Although we can't say that we've got widespread use of that, it was mentioned somewhat in the Kyoto protocols, but it's become much more common in, for instance, the sulfur market for stationary source power plants. And so we've actually developed markets in the for sulfur dioxide, where we trade sulfur dioxide credits or permits. And you have a choice of either reducing your sulfur dioxide or alternatively coming along and buying a permit and continuing to emit the sulfur dioxide. The other possibilities are taxes or sometimes subsidies, where we charge people a BTU tax, a carbon tax. Those are other alternatives. The difference between taxes and subsidies, and the so-called cap and trade type of approach is that in one case we set the limits and we give only so many permits or rights to use carbon. And that was cap and trade. The taxes are levied on the amount of carbon used, and the idea is that we will get to the same level of carbon usage by taxing high enough the use of carbon in the process. One of the problems with these systems, and I'll talk a little bit more about that later, is that the institutional setting of setting up these markets, certifying and so forth, is rather complicated. And that's where we end up with a lot of problems along the way.
Thank you. I'm under the understanding that my microphone is now out. Is that correct? It does say low battery. So if you guys can't hear me back, just make sure you wave your hand, and I'll try and speak as loudly as I can. That wraps up our first topic. The next topic we're going to move to are the costs and benefits of not taking action on climate change. Again, we're going to start with Professor Tockley. In the next several decades, if the United States does not enact emissions reductions policies and the international community halts at Kyoto Protocol standards, what physical changes will likely result and by what time?
Well, we're already committed to a warming over the next 40 years, so it won't really make much difference what we do in the next 40 years. We're already committed to a warming. So what the policy decisions that we make with regard to emissions are really based on, are really going to influence the latter half of the 21st century, because we've already committed ourselves to a substantial warming and a pretty substantial change, which we can already see is taking place. So when we think about the future, we need to think about clearly about a mitigation period and an adaptation period. And the next 40 or 50 years is really the adaptation period. We've already pretty much determined that we're going to have climate change in that period, and we know pretty much on a global scale how much that is. We don't know as well on a regional scale. But if we want to change something, we need to do it now, but it won't have an effect for 50 years.
All right, thank you. All right, I think I'm back on track here, right? The next question will move to Dr. Baranowski. If the United States fails to act, what are the projected economic implications of ignoring global warming?
We can break this down into about five sets of issues, some of which Dr. Tackley has already mentioned. One of the areas is the aggregate impacts on the global economy in the process. And in that case, if we're looking ahead 40, 50 years, I would argue, and a lot of the models come up with the impact that the estimates that the impacts on aggregate or in total are probably not going to be that large. What's going to happen is that we're going to have winners and losers, and some big winners and some big losers. For a country like the United States looking out for 50 years, on net, we're probably going to come out without too large of impacts. Simply, we're going to have some regions that are probably going to go out of crop production, and other regions where crop production will be enhanced by global warming. If you're down in the south, it might get pretty hot. If you're up in the Midwest here, it might change the crops we're growing and make a lot of differences there. And when we look at local and regional impacts, some of those could be quite severe. There could be flooding in certain areas of the country or the world. And so those are where I'm most concerned about those impacts of the next 40 or 50 years. Dr. Tackley mentioned adaptation. And one of the reasons we can adjust fairly well, particularly in the more developed countries, is that we've got technologies that are geared to some of the changes that are coming. If you want to take something like hybrid corn, we've developed varieties that are much more drought tolerant than they were 40, 50 years ago, or even 25 years ago. So that allows us then to shift varieties and adapt. And that's in part due to the ongoing research that we've got in the system, both in the government as well as in the universities and so forth. So the impacts are not going to be too great. The second thing is that a lot, as long as the aggregate impacts don't change a lot, trade flows are going to shift or change. And countries that are exporting now may become importing countries, particularly if they're in areas of the country or world where things are really going to be affected adversely. And so those things on average are going to balance things out in a way that's not going to be that detrimental. Where I have my biggest concern, though, is when we deal with issues of the developing world, and particularly with respect to poverty and malnutrition. Areas of the tropical areas, areas of Africa and so forth, are going to be very adversely affected. A country like China, even though it's very large, is seeing some significant adverse impacts already. So that it's not necessarily what the aggregate impacts are, it's who the winners and losers are, and how costly is it going to be to them, and what possibilities do they have to adapt. The smaller the country is, the less opportunities they're going to have to adapt to those changes and adjust in the process.
Thank you. Dr. Schmidt, how would the long-run physical, economic, and social impacts of global warming affect governments and political relations?
Well, one of the interesting things is that in order to have governments move in a certain direction, you have to, at least in democratic societies or societies where elections matter, you have to have public opinion moving in that direction. And I just popped up some polls here that I was looking at today. And in most public opinion polls, I have one here which is very reliable. What do you think is the most important problem facing this country today? Global warming and climate change is nowhere on the list of this particular poll at all, and there are about 8 or 9 topics that are there. The Wall Street Journal NBC News poll of March 2nd through 5th of 2007 also has public opinion is not at all focused on the issues of global warming and climate change. And in the CNN opinion research poll of January 19 through 21, which is the most recent one, global warming is 9th out of all the issues. So maybe that's progress. You know, maybe there is some growing awareness that climate change, global warming, issues related to that are in fact something that's important that we ought to be considering when we look at candidates, when we look at parties, when we look at the structuring of political campaigns and future governments. It is interesting also that today John Edwards, just down the road here in my town in Nevada, issued kind of a major sort of policy position on climate change, global warming, and especially on essentially moving to alternative technologies and more environmentally friendly technologies. And it is also interesting, at least in the US, that when people start talking about who might be an alternative candidate to Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama and so on, Al Gore's name is coming up. And Al Gore's name is coming up primarily because of his very visible role with the Oscars and so on, and his position on environmental issues. So those things suggest that politicians and governments are in fact becoming more aware. And if I were to cite you the Canadian public opinion polls, which I saw just this afternoon, the environment, climate change, and global warming is the number one issue in Canada politically. In Europe, it's very important. But it's also interesting that in a country like Germany, which is very aware of and very sensitive to global warming and climate change, and they have been a leader in this, the one thing they will not tolerate is to change the speed limits on the German autobahns. That became a gigantic issue this week when the European community said, well, you've got to put some speed limits on those parts of your superhighways where people can drive at any speed. And the Germans said, no way. We're willing to do all kinds of stuff for, you know, the environment and the world, but we're not going to give up the right to drive, you know, at any speed that our Porsches can go at on the German autobahns. So there's still some education, you know, that needs to be done before politicians and governments are fully invested in policies related to the issues that we're talking about here.
Excellent. Our next topic will be on the cost and benefits of taking action on global warming. Professor Tucker, if global warming is addressed, what physical impacts can be avoided at this point, and which ones are inevitable?
As I indicated, we have in the long term there could be major consequences of not taking action. James Hansen was born and raised in Denison, Iowa. Went to school at the University of Iowa and studied under James Van Allen, famous astrophysicist. He's now the director of the Goddard Institute for Space Studies in New York City. And he shows a graph that he published in probably several places, but I saw it in Scientific American in 2004 in the March issue. It shows what he calls the radiative imbalance. And this is the amount of increased radiation in terms of watts per square meter that are coming into the Earth system over and above the natural levels due to the greenhouse gases. And he shows that this curve now, it's the instantaneous radiative imbalance, and it's now at 7/10 of a watt per square meter. And that doesn't sound like very much, but it's a cumulative effect, and it's going to stay with us for a long time because carbon dioxide has a long lifetime in the atmosphere. He contends that if this imbalance reaches 1 watt per square meter, that will put us on an irreversible path towards significant climate change. And the consequence of that will be that we will set in motion the irreversible melting of the Greenland ice sheet. And this would take several hundred years. It's important to recognize that. It's a long process, but it's one that once you set it in motion, then you can't change it. And the consequences of melting the ice on Greenland, even if Antarctica is unaffected, would be to raise sea level by about 6 to 7 meters, which is 20 feet. And that would inundate a substantial fraction of the globe's population.
Dr. Radowski, if the United States does take action, namely through a cap and trade policy or through the Kyoto Protocol systems, what will the economic implications of that be?
First of all, I want to just to clarify one thing. I don't see Kyoto Protocol as it was drafted as being a solution per se. But one of the things they had in it were certain trading opportunities such as cap and trade. And I think those are extremely important. And why they're important is because within a market system, those changes come about automatically, as opposed to in a command and control system, where those changes have to be dictated, if you will, by the commanders that are in control. And what I'm talking about is this, that when you make changes in the overall economy and you send signals by prices, you start changing people's behavior. You get them to use less carbon with a carbon tax or with a carbon cap because they have to pay more for that carbon they're using, and you get them to substitute something in place of it, or to conserve the energy source. And so that's why I think cap and trade is not something that has to be dictated to consumers or to industry. We let prices and the market system guide the outcome. In terms of sectoral impacts, it all depends on how cap and trade is implemented. We can do it in a very simple way by putting a charge or a cap on primary carbon. And a cap on primary carbon or a tax on primary carbon, either at the refinery level, at the coal mining level, whichever level we want in fossil fuels, we could do that, and that would affect costs of high carbon energy all the way up the line. And so if you were carbon intensive in your industry or your household, you'd pay a much higher price than if you were not carbon intensive. And so that changes behavior of producers and consumers both in the process. In some sectors, like let's say for instance the electricity sector, it could have a huge impact. Because with something like sulfur dioxide where we have trading, producers could switch from high sulfur eastern coal to low sulfur Wyoming coal and save a lot or meet the cap and not have to buy a lot of sulfur credits in the process. Within something like the electrical system, if we then had a tax or a tradable permit system, cap and trade system, with power companies, switching from one form of coal to another form of coal makes no difference in the amount of carbon coming out. So that particular sector would be impacted much heavier than some other sectors in the economy. Or those that are very efficient in their use of electricity would tend to benefit. The aggregate economic impacts, I don't think, would be that significant. Why? Because we have a lot of substitution opportunities in the economy as a whole. So as the price went up, we would then tend to shift, let's say, from I would save energy if I was a low-intensity industry and sell my credits to the electrical industry, which is a high-intensity industry, and so we would balance it out across the economy and the impacts wouldn't be too great. Environmental policies in the past or regulations in a number of studies has been shown to spur economic growth because it brings about new investment, it substitutes new technologies in, and so it can be very beneficial in that sense. I think our government in many ways, even with incentives, tries to take more of a sectoral approach than an economy-wide approach. And a good example of that is with biofuels as a way of reducing carbon. Biofuels are not a silver bullet. There's no silver bullet out there in this energy situation, not even hydrogen. If you read about hydrogen, there are many vast problems out there to be surmounted, let alone having workable technology in the next 50 years. So I think one of the big things here is the impacts would not be too great. The benefits, environmentally and otherwise, I think could be very huge, particularly given where the trends are going, and that after 50 years, the global warming effects are going to have very significant impacts on the economy and on the global economy as well.
Great. And then, Dr. Schmidt, you went a little bit into the Edwards campaign. I was going to go a little deeper on that topic. How beneficial is it for politicians to include global warming in their central platform, and will this change in the years to come?
Well, if we had this thing connected up there to that LCD projector, I'll just flip this around so you can see Arnold Schwarzenegger and the other governors of the Western states, there is already a sense that people are interested in initiatives that address this issue. And the Western governors, depicted here in this picture, have come together with a project to address this issue. Whether they can fulfill that or not is another question. But those are some pretty powerful states. The other thing is that 8 in 10 Americans support pro-environmental policies, and that's a pretty significant number. The only problem is that only 22% of Americans said that they would vote for candidates for federal, state, or local elections based on the position of those candidates on environmental issues. So there's still a disconnect between people feeling that the environment is important, that they should do something about it themselves, and so on, and their willingness to essentially make voting on environmental issues a high priority at this point for candidates. But in this stuff that I was researching this afternoon, there are already hundreds of cities, suburbs, and rural communities in the United States in particular that have taken individual steps themselves to deal with issues of energy consumption, reduce emissions of pollutants that cause climate change, and so on. So the process is not, I think it's a mistake to think that we have to focus on presidential candidates as the source of this. The U.S. is a federal system. We've got some students here in, who have studied this intensively with me and know that federalism allows you to experiment with stuff in the United States, even if the federal government is a recidivist or is behind. And I think that's the exciting and interesting thing, is that cities like Fargo, North Dakota, and Carmel, Indiana, which is a suburb of Indianapolis, are launching initiatives to try and put their automotive fleets into hybrids and replace all the light bulbs that are in city buildings with LED bulbs, which use 80% less energy than other bulbs. And so if you can get a grassroots kind of movement going, you don't have to necessarily have presidential candidates in the federal government, in the case of the U.S., become the leader on this, because the nice thing about a system like the United States is that leadership can come from state and local communities, and there seems to be some evidence that that's happening on this issue. So it's a real sea change, I think, from, let's say, 10 years ago, when this was not an issue that most mayors of small towns or certainly the governor of California would want to take on. And I think that's, a very hopeful sign.
All right. We'll move to our final topic here, which is just more of a general outlook on the issue. Professor Tocchi, what is the emissions reduction timeline in order to avoid the risk of severe consequences?
Well, we now put in the atmosphere between 7 and 8 gigatons of carbon a year, and we've got to somehow get a handle on that and cut down the impact of that on warming. There are two things that could, well, first of all, following on the comment that I made previously about Jim Hansen's radiative forcing, if you project his curve, his trend of increase in radiative forcing into the future, you see that by, and you believe his 1 watt per square meter tipping point, that we would reach that in about 2018. So we have about 10 years, according to him, before we reach this irreversible point. But one way is to reduce our emissions of greenhouse gases. Another one, which he contends is something that we can get a handle on, is to reduce the emission of black carbon. Black carbon is emitted by combustion diesel engines and power plants and so on, and that it leads to a warming, and that's something that he thinks we can get a handle on with lower economic investment. Another interesting thing that's happened, we don't quite understand why, another major greenhouse gas that we don't talk about very much, although it's a very powerful one, is methane, CH4, and it's much lower in abundance. pre-industrial levels were 700 parts per billion. It's now up, it's more than doubled that in the last 200 years. It's up to 1,700 parts per billion. It's 20 times as powerful as greenhouse gas as carbon dioxide. But for some reason, it has been shooting up until just the last 5 years or so, and now it's stabilized and has not increased. And it's thought that that might be due to capping a bunch of leaky natural gas lines in Siberia, but that's the best that I've seen. If that's true, that's encouraging that there are some things that we can do, and nobody has suffered terribly economically because of the capping of these leaky natural gas lines. So maybe there are some things that we can do just to be better stewards of what we're already doing.
Dr. Schmidt, will there be political will at the public and elite level to enact stringent policies beyond the proposals today, such as Kyoto?
I think one of the problems is that we really do have two different worlds. And you talk about the first world and the third world. The second world has sort of disappeared with the end of the Soviet Union. But in countries like the United States, I think we have not only the ability but also the desire to deal with these issues. But the real problem is there are a lot of countries in the world, and that's the majority of countries and the majority of people in the world live in countries that have, number one, very unstable governments that are very ineffective, and even if the governments had the intention of implementing policies that would address some of these issues, you know, they don't reach outside the capital city of the country. That makes it very difficult, even with enlightened leaders in the capital city, to accomplish many of these goals. So one of the concerns that I have as a political scientist is that regardless of the science and the economics, which are rational and which ought to be implemented in ways that, you know, maximize the positive effects of what we know, in many countries in the world, that's just unrealistic because the governments are weak, the governments are corrupt, the governments are essentially often hostages to institutions or organizations that have no interest in implementing these policies. And so I see an optimistic picture in those countries where governments are well organized and have some legitimacy and can in fact cooperate internationally in accomplishing these things. And I'm very pessimistic in many, many of the areas of the world where governments are barely hanging on and where it's a tough sell to get them to implement environmental policies because they can barely implement any other kinds of policies. And I think that, as a political scientist, I think that stable and semi-democratic governments are crucial to solving this problem. And we need to work very hard to try to get more governments in the world to be both stable and a little bit democratic.
Final question for Dr. Marinowski. What are the best policy techniques to reach these targets?
I guess I will probably start out by being a little more pessimistic than Professor Schmidt. I see the problem with the democratic developed country governments as being much more serious than with the developing country governments, even though they may be very inefficient and not effective political systems. And the reason is that those countries are not, for the most part, the major emitters of greenhouse gases. The major emitters of greenhouse gases are the developed countries of the world. And why I see it is the fact that I see the market solution. I consider myself a free market economist, and I consider the market solution to be the best solution because it's the most effective way, or the way of getting the biggest bang for the bucks on environmental or greenhouse gas reductions. What I don't see, though, from a political economy point of view, is the will, the commitment to do that, to give up what we've got to give up to get there. And I very much prefer going the cap and trade or the tax solution to this problem. Where I have a problem is that I don't think we have the willpower to set a tight enough cap to make a meaningful difference. We don't have the willpower to impose a high enough tax to achieve the target we're setting for ourselves. Because that's going to be costly. It's not necessarily going to have huge economic impacts on the economy, but in some sectors, some people are going to be very adversely affected. And we don't have the willpower, or at least our politicians don't have the willpower, to call those hard shots and make those difficult decisions. Let me use a little demonstration to make that point. We have two cap and trade exchanges, we actually have more than that, but the two key ones right now operating are the Chicago Climate Exchange. One is a CO2 trading scheme, which has been around since I think December 2003, and another one, which is sulfur dioxide for stationary source emitters. The sulfur dioxide one has a charge because EPA put a pretty tight cap. It has a charge of between $500 and $1,000 a ton of sulfur dioxide. The CO2 exchange has a price per ton of carbon dioxide, and you can say it's not as detrimental to the environment as CO2 is, so it should be a higher price, of $4. It started out at one, it went up to four over the last 5 years, 4 years. And the thing to think about here is why. You know, I've seen figures of $50 to $80, $90 a ton for carbon is what we should be looking at. And the reason is there's no cap. There's no incentive. So why would you pay very much for carbon or for a carbon permit if that was the way the system worked? And I think that's a very good illustration of what's going to happen if we don't have the willpower to put a tight cap. California is putting in a system under AV 32, or Assembly Bill 32 that was passed. And it's very interesting to see how complicated the implementation of that program is being envisioned. And we'll have regulations and every carbon standards in there and everything else before it's over. I don't think it's going to be able to accomplish what we want to accomplish. So I guess what I would say in the end here is the government as a regulator can't pick winners. They can't pick the sectors that we ought to be making changes in. They can't pick the energy sources we ought to be using. They can't pick the best technology. That's what we found out under command and control. But we've got, and that's simply because we don't have the political economy and the information that we need to make informed decisions in the hands of bureaucrats. But what we really need to be doing here is focusing on the greenhouse gas reduction target and figuring out the most effective way of getting it. I'm reminded of a little cartoon that's on the International Climate Change Partnership website. And it shows a dinosaur talking to a group of dinosaurs. And he says, "Gentlemen, the picture is bleak. Mammals are coming, or climate's changing, mammals are coming, and we have brains the size of walnuts." My translation of that today would be, climate change is happening. The mammals are here, or man is here, already, but we don't have the political will to make the changes that are going to be needed to make this, or to save the planet and not have extreme adverse conditions in the future. I think as Professor Tackley said, we've got to act now and we're not going to see impacts for 50 years. If we don't act pretty soon, we're not going to see impacts at all, and that consequences may be very, very severe.
Excellent. Well, that concludes our descriptive question section. So I'd like to thank you guys very much for participating in that. And also, we'll be opening it up to questions from all of you now. And I'll just come on down to the front here if you have a question for anyone, professor, or all three.
I need a drink.
Okay, so AIDS is becoming considered a fairly progressive community. Say that we were to abide by the Kyoto Protocol, how long, realistically, would you say AIDS, a community such as AIDS, would take to get greenhouse emissions under the 1990 level, 7% of the 1990 level? Any estimates?
That's you.
Well, I think if we had some incentives, I think it could happen pretty fast. I mean, you have a community here that is highly educated, and they do pay attention to things. I think that although there's still a tremendous amount of apathy, even in the Ames community, and lack of understanding of the whole climate issue. So first, they have to understand that there's a problem. But I mean, we have a well used, for our community our size, a well used bus system. We have a lot of people that ride bikes. We have a good city at least 6-8 months of the year to ride bicycles. If we could be a leader in technology and teleconferencing, we could do a better job with so we aren't running all over the place, going to conferences and things like that. And I'm one of the worst at that. Probably have double a CO2 footprint of anybody in terms of just, I'm never where I'm supposed to be. So I think if we really had a commitment, we could make a difference, I think, in a pretty big hurry. And changing light bulbs, you know, some simple things we could be doing, and most people haven't done this yet, and we could have a pretty sizable impact.
I've heard some people talk about these supposedly scrubbers in power plant stacks that can scrub the carbon right out of the carbon dioxide. Now, as an engineer, that just seems impossible by conservation of energy. Would that be right there?
Yeah, I think you've been well taught. I visited Basin Electric. I was invited by Basin Electric to come up in Bismarck, North Dakota, to come up talk to their stockholders meeting. And I chatted with some of the people there, and they have what they're doing is they're experimenting with piping their carbon dioxide into underground caverns. And there have been attempts to pipe it and store it in the deep ocean. But you're right. The laws of chemistry and physics say that to break up carbon dioxide just takes a lot of energy.
It takes the same amount of energy
that
you got out of producing.
Absolutely. So, you know, it is. There's nothing easy about doing that.
Do you know of any other crackpot ideas out there?
Oh, there are a lot of crackpot ideas.
One thing I guess we should actually talk about is hydrogen an energy source?
Well, drill a hole in the ground, see if it squirts out. It probably won't. There's no place we can get hydrogen. It doesn't lie around. We can't dig it up. It takes energy to produce hydrogen.
So it's really just like a battery.
Yeah. It's a way of moving energy around. Yeah, it's a good at that. So if we had some, you know, if we had a big farm of windmills out in the middle of the Pacific or something that were just generating a lot of electricity and breaking water into hydrogen oxygen and pipe the hydrogen into land. That, you know, something like that would work. But you've got to generate the energy to break the bonds.
Just wanted to have you clear that up. I know I've heard a lot of people, I think there's a lot of people out there who think that hydrogen is the source that's going to
No.
My question
I read a study just yesterday that said that the United States has, I think, 18 times as many automobiles as China, despite the fact that China has a dramatically larger population. I'm wondering, from an economic perspective and a political perspective, how do we get China on board with this global climate change business, especially considering their sort of fledgling economic state where they are significantly behind the United States, but catching up rapidly? How do we, I say we loosely, the United States or the United Nations, whoever, how do you get China on board to cooperate and participate in making these changes for the betterment of the global system?
I think one way of doing that is with an effective cap and trade policy. And the reason I say that is I've seen some research that's been done on what the impacts would be in terms of technology development with an effective cap and trade system in the developed countries. And if that technology is developed, it's obviously going to be made available to developing countries in the process, like China. I mean, when I've been in China, the cars are small, for the most part. A lot of them are probably heavily polluting. I don't know if that's still true, but when I was there, I saw some that were pretty sad. And, I think what we need to be doing is moving toward technology. China is moving ahead on biofuels and alternative fuel sources. I view China and India to be big competitors in the energy game. There are two biggest competitors in the petroleum import area and the natural gas import area right now. But, at the same time, I have to agree with what Professor Schmidt said earlier. I can't deny them the right to grow. But I think if we can provide them technology access and so forth, it's going to have a very positive effect on how they grow. If nothing else, they'll be very interested in building cars with that technology in China to ship here. And so that gives them incentive to work it into the overall system.
Well, the one thing that's surprising to me is that the word nuclear energy hasn't come up here. And that's because most of us in the room like this, most of us in a community like Ames, most of us who are sort of liberal Democrats and so on, just don't want to go there. And that was one of the biggest mistakes that was made 30 or 40 years ago, was essentially to shut down the development of nuclear energy, which, in some respects at least, bypasses these problems, though it potentially creates other problems. But it certainly doesn't produce these problems. And, there is, as you know, a kind of chest-beating mea culpa going on among environmentalists and some very significant leaders in the environmental movement who are saying that one of the biggest mistakes that were made 30 or more years ago was essentially to pretty much prevent the development of new levels of nuclear technology, which could have avoided the commitment to coal-fired and gas and not so much oil, because oil isn't really used to fire power plants and so on, but to invest in that technology. Because when we're talking here about sources of energy, I mean, frankly, we don't have too many sources of energy. It's bullshit to talk about all the alternative energies that are out there. I saw a wonderful table in the New York Times, which you can see here on my computer, if you could see it up on the screen. And it showed the continued growth of the use of petroleum, and it showed the growth of the use of alternative energies, including, all kinds of solar, wind and so on. And there is no growth. The growth is all in hydrocarbons. And so if we're going to start talking about alternative energies, we better come up with something that is a realistic alternative to petroleum, because we're not running out of petroleum. That's another myth that this person who calls my radio show about regularly every two or three weeks on WI talks about how we're out of oil, there's no more petroleum. And the truth of the matter is there is a hell of a lot of petroleum out there. It just depends on the $80 a barrel price to be able to go down and get it. And a lot of it is offshore in very, very deep waters, which we can now drill on. It is in old wells where, you know, new steam technologies where they can pump, you know, superheated steam down into old oil fields, and they can bring up stuff that they couldn't bring up before. So, the era of big oil is not by any means over, and I think that's the scariest part to me, is that you people out there in all these engineering and chemistry and other areas of science, you haven't come up with anything new. There are no new sources of energy. You know, why don't you get to work, go into the labs, and come up with something that's a realistic alternative to petroleum? Because right now there isn't one. You know, that's what my biggest concern.
Can I follow up on that just a second? And one of the things I'd like to say, I agree with Professor Schmidt on this, the nuclear energy issue. I think in some ways, as Devin, who had the unfortunate experience of sitting through my class, I frequently preach in a market system about the evils of cheap energy. I know that probably doesn't make me very popular, at least with some of the students in the process, because they say, gee, it costs me X amount to fill up my vehicle now after the price of gasoline has gone to $3. But this is why I trust in a market system, is simply because if we hadn't fostered a cheap energy policy and the price of petroleum was a lot higher than it is today, then we would have been able to compete with nuclear energy that would have been a lot safer. But what we did is we took bigger risks with nuclear energy simply because it was cheaper and we could compete with fossil fuels and coal in the market. The same thing happens with the development of renewable fuels. Why? Because if gasoline is going to be really cheap, you know, the only way we're going to get ethanol or some other biofuel is to come along and subsidize that product so it can compete. And if we'd let the market work, we'd be far ahead, and we'd have some of those technologies that your predecessors in engineering would have developed if there was a big enough reward for development. So, you know, I think to some extent we're the victims of a cheap energy policy instead of the recipients of the benefits of a cheap energy policy as we face this issue with carbon today.
Interesting. My question is, has much research or attention been looked at for methane hydrates releasing methane in the atmosphere through rising ocean temperatures?
I know that that's it's somewhat of a concern, although I don't know that it's been quantified, or I can't say that it doesn't show up on the radar screen as being one of the climate surprises, for instance, that's mentioned. If it should happen, I mean, if we should get a huge release, and we had a big belch by the ocean and it put all its stuff in the atmosphere, because of the radiative forcing of methane, it would have a substantial and a very sudden impact. But the lifetime of methane is a lot shorter, so you'd have to tough it out for 30 years, but beyond that, then it would come back to normal.
Hi, so my name is Vincent, I'm from Canada. So I have one question for you. How would you explain the lack of political and public will in the United States regarding climate change? Because you talked about India and China, and you said that in the future you see like nuclear power and then. But I guess that I think that the US are the biggest producer of gas emissions. And right now they're definitely not leaders about that, and not even followers. So how can you explain that?
I can't defend where we are. I think to some extent, though, it gets back to my last response, is we're a victim of that cheap energy cost. And people know that they don't want to go to the pump and fill up $3 plus a gallon. If we had followed a program like Europe and parts of South America and so forth of high taxes on gasoline years and years ago, instead of subsidizing the industry, we would have seen a very different pattern of development in this country. We wouldn't see all people living out in the burbs or the small farms 5-10 miles from the city, simply because the transportation costs would have kept us closer into those. And so you can see a lot of things that are coming along, and once that culture is there, it doesn't change very fast. But I agree it should. That's why I'm saying we really ought to be looking at some tight caps, and we really ought to be looking at some high taxes on carbon, not necessarily gasoline per se, but just carbon, as ways of stimulating the system and getting it to work more efficiently in the process. And I think people may be surprised that the consequences are not being as dramatic as they anticipate. I mean, the group at this table were young gentlemen back in 1980-81 when gasoline topped out at, was it close to $3 a gallon? Well, it wasn't at that time, but it was the equivalent of $3.09 a gallon. We hit that very briefly right after the hurricanes. But we're a long ways below right now. I mean, we're 35% below, roughly, the peak in 1981. And so we're not getting a very good signal. We can say, you know, if we look at inflated prices, we can say that we're paying $2.45 a gallon now or something around eight. But in reality, you take compare that back to what we had in 1981, it's still quite a bit below. And so I would argue we're just not getting the signals there. And as Stefan argued, that's what's going to bring out advanced recovery techniques. That's what's going to lead to forcing more carbon dioxide down those old wells or fields and forcing the oil up in the process. And that's where we need to be headed. But we're not going to do that unless it's value, or the oil's costly enough to go after it or control the process.
Yeah, and I'm looking here at a report by a Canadian government agency, and Canada isn't doing so well either. I mean, Canada, it says here, has one of the largest supplies of hydrocarbons in the world and is the fifth largest energy producer in the world, and net exporter of energy. Most of Canada's energy comes from fossil fuels, oil 32%, gas 24%, coal 13%. So, you know, we tend to think of Canada as being nice and green and so on, but Canada also has a lot of energy resources that if the price hits $80 a barrel, for example, the oil sands in Canada, which are larger than the oil reserves of Saudi Arabia, become economically very attractive, and Canada is going to start really, it's already doing it, but it'll really start exploiting oil sands, which are a pretty nasty source of oil, because you have to really dig up, you know, almost all of the sands in which the oil is trapped with gigantic machines that are the largest in the world and squeeze it out of there with some pretty nasty processes. The Athabasca is the single largest oil deposit in the world, and so we are all trapped because the scientists have failed us. The scientists have not, in fact, produced for us sources of energy that are alternatives to the stuff that is economically feasible. And the reason is economics, because, you know, there is no incentive for scientists to develop it because nobody is going to then implement it. And so it's a chicken and egg problem, which I think we have to really address pretty seriously. I mean, China would like to consume as much energy as we do. Right now, I don't see the Chinese government as being very interested in being conservationist. Chinese are going from bicycles to small cars, and they want to go from small cars to large cars. And my understanding is that one of the best markets for Humvees in the world is and Suburbans is China, the People's Republic of China. Because people who have become very wealthy, they don't want to ride a bicycle. They don't want to drive around in shitty little cars. They want to ride around in quiet, big SUVs that can, you know, run over all those people in bicycles. It's just human nature.
Just the ones.
Maybe I'm too pessimistic here. I don't know. Sorry about that.
One of the predictions of global warming, perhaps somewhat controversial, is that there will be increased frequency and severity of storms. I guess, some elucidation on the scientific status of that prediction, and then also what are the economic and political consequences of that.
Yeah, I think that's one aspect that's it's easy to blow out of its proper proportion because we've all seen storms when we were all as children we were all terrified by storms, and so more of them is a bad thing. And actually, as a side note, I kind of worry, as I give a lot of talks around to various groups, I kind of worry about the potential impact on children, young children, of hearing some of these things. As to the science of storms, there was a study by Carrie Emanuel of MIT that indicated that the power dissipation index of hurricanes has increased dramatically since 1975. And the power dissipation index goes at the cube of the wind speed, and if the wind speed increases a little, the power index increases a lot. That report has been disputed by other scientists, and the question is still out on that. But just a back-of-the-envelope calculation, or just fundamental thinking about how hurricanes work, they draw their energy from warm water, and if the ocean temperatures are rising, which they are, it means that tropical storms are pretty likely to be more intensive. So I think that ultimately it will be shown that tropical cyclones, hurricanes, will become more intense. There's no evidence that they are going to be more frequent, but that they may be more intense. Mid-latitude storms, the kind of stuff that we get, there's no evidence that I know of that indicates there are more tornadoes or severe storms than there were 50 years ago. It's hard to get a handle on because there are more people now reporting more, but that doesn't necessarily mean that more are occurring. It is already occurring that we get more of our rainfall in intense rainfall events, and that's also predicted by models, so that's pretty likely to continue in the future. And we're getting more rainfall, and more of our rainfall comes in extreme events. So we could be headed toward, at the same time, more floods and more droughts. But in terms of more in the whole category of storms, I think that's, in my view, that's a little bit overblown.
Good evening. The university takes a lot of my money, and one thing that comes to mind is that that energy little fee that they have that gets tacked onto our tuition. Does the university do anything to invest in new technologies, or is that just used to supplement our old habits?
Yes. I mean, I've been here for 36 years. And during that period of time, what I've seen is when the budgets get really tight and there are problems, they unscrew some of the light bulbs so that Ross Hall gets a lot darker. And then when that period is over and the legislature provides some more funding, they screw the bulbs back in again. I mean, I just honestly have not seen any green campus initiatives. There are a lot of universities in the country that have gone very aggressively for green campuses, where they are really doing assessments of all the energy uses and trying to improve the performance of everything in the university or college. I have really not seen much of that at Iowa State.
Thank you.
I see a lot of buildings, new buildings, that to me at least don't seem like they're probably very energy efficient. They're all glass, you know, and so on. And that's maybe an economic factor. I mean, maybe there's an economic explanation for why. Maybe there are no incentives for doing that. I don't know, but perhaps our economists would.
A number of universities, as Dr. Smith was saying, have done this. I know that the University of Iowa is doing some things in their power plant with burning hotels from Cedar Rapids and so forth. And there are a number of universities that have adopted green building policies. Economists are not as favored as political scientists, I just learned, because when they disconnected our light bulbs in Petty Hall in 1981 or in the early 80s, they never did reconnect. So we've been in the dark ever since.
But economists have been in the dark for even longer than that. So
I help myself. What I did want to say, though, is it's very interesting because the impact of the prices of the early 80s brought about other changes. They shut down the heat further. They shut down the heat to a very low level, like 50 degrees over holiday, or fall, or winter breaks and stuff. I mean, they made a lot more efforts at that time. I haven't seen as much now as I did back in the 80s. And I don't know why we haven't responded to bigger role.
I mean, can I just finish with one additional comment? I mean, I think energy prices aren't high enough. In other words, I think you can still get away with having lots of lights all over the place and energy inefficiency, because you can still essentially raise students' fees and tuition and get the legislature to kick in and do other things and get away with it. So that we're still in a pretty cheap energy period of history. And I think when that changes, you become a lot more conscious of those cost factors. It's all economics in the end, and politics, but mostly economics. And science, a little bit, but nobody pays much attention to scientists. Unless you can work out the economic and political aspects of science, science is sort of irrelevant, really, unless you can figure these two things out. And that's actually the truth.
Well, this question is directed mostly at Professor Tuckley. Can you talk a little bit about just how catastrophic global warming is going to be if we don't enact serious regulations? Because I watched Al Gore's documentary, and he talks about the state of Florida being underwater in 100 years. Is it going to be that bad?
Probably not. I don't know that he mentioned that he said that it would be underwater in 100 years. I think he did refer to the melting of the Greenland ice sheet, which would, as I indicated, raise sea level by about 6 meters. That would inundate the southern third of Florida and put the Washington Monument on an island and a few other things. That's one long-term thing. We have, there are two aspects. You talk about catastrophes, and we do think about that and look around for what could be a major global catastrophe, and two are possible. One is the shutdown of the thermohaline circulation, which is the normal ocean circulation that moves warm water from the tropical regions toward the polar regions, where it then, particularly in the North Atlantic, where it sinks and then goes returns back to the Pacific Ocean at depth, and it leads to what we call the conveyor belt. And that conveyor belt shut down when we were coming out of the last ice age, because the North Atlantic flooded with fresh water. Fresh water rides on top of the more dense salt water. And so it interfered with that conveyor belt. And there's some thought that maybe the melting of Greenland could have the same effect. And so that could really change global climate in a substantial way. The other climate surprise, and here we're talking about high impact, low probability events. Now, meteorologists aren't used to talking about that. We like to talk about means and averages and things like that. But insurance people like to talk about low probability, high impact events, because that's where they lose their shirts. And they can also charge high premiums because they can convince everybody else that there might be a chance that you also would lose your shirt. So the one that comes to mind there, the other one, is the breakoff of the West Antarctic ice sheet. And that is, Antarctica is a huge mountain, and we have this ice that keeps building up on the middle of the mountain, and it slides down slowly toward the sea and breaks off and floats away. But there's one huge chunk that's cantilevered out over the ocean that if it should break off, it also would raise sea level by about 7 meters, but it would do so over a very short period of time, a few weeks or something like that, not 400 years. Now that'd be a surprise, and it'd be an unpleasant surprise, particularly for 2 billion people that live in coastal areas. So that's one that catastrophe that comes to mind. We know that that's not a high, as I said, it's not a highly likely event, although the movement of these ice sheets is accelerating, and the pinning point is being undermined by a warmer ocean, and so there are some evidence that we are accelerating toward some kind of break-off, but it may be 100, 200 years away. But I would, if Al Gore said that we could have 7 meter, or 6 or 7 meter rise in sea level in 100 years, I don't remember him saying that, but that is important to know. I thought, when I saw his movie, I thought that he backed away from being really dramatic on these things. I think he could have been a lot more using, you know, credible peer-reviewed science, but I thought that he was pretty even-handed, although a lot of people don't see it that way.
All right. Well, I think that wraps it up. I want to thank everybody for coming. And let's give these guys a hand.
Very good.
That was fun.
Yeah, this is what it used to look like.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Pangea.
Yeah, right.
Thank you all again. And if you are interested in the things that we're doing on campus to address climate change,
Because it's well above the ocean. It's not floating on it. See, the north of the Arctic is floating on it. When you melt
all of that, you displace the water.
That's right, yeah.
Whereas this would displace a lot of water.
Yeah, this would be, the glass is already full and you drop an ice cube in. If the ice cube is already in the glass, it melts. It's not going to spill water.
But look, this is what the... This is what the world has looked like before. Has looked like before. Has looked like before. Has looked like before.